الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا أما بعد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته Before I begin, can I ask everyone to please come forward, inshallah ta'ala. It's from the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that when we are within the masajid, within the houses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that we're close to one another. The Sahaba and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he would dislike it when the companions were scattered. And that scattering shows the distance between the hearts of the Muslims. So try to stay as close as possible whenever you are in the masajid, inshallah ta'ala. So inshallah, today what I'm going to do is I'm going to be going through a passage from the Quran. A passage from specifically Surah Az-Zumar, inshallah ta'ala, which highlights to us something in regards to the Day of Judgment, in regards to Yawm Al-Qiyamah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He explains to us about the people when the trumpet is blown, and where the people will go, the believers, where they will go, and the disbelievers, where will they go. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sets the scene for us and gives us a very detailed explanation in regards to that. Now, before I go into that, I wanted to mention to you a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, بُعِثْتُ أَنَا وَسَاعَةَ كَهَاتَيْنِ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said in a very famous hadith, which many of you have probably heard, he said, Bu'ithtu, he said, I was sent, Bu'ithtu, ana wa sa'a, me and the hour striking, me and the day of judgment coming, the hour striking, we were sent, kahatain. And the narrator of the hadith mentions that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he brought his index and his middle finger like this, to show that how close these two fingers are with one another, is how close the sending of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the coming of the Day of Judgment is. Now I want you guys to just imagine when the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was alive back then, 1400 plus years ago, he said, Bu'ithtu ana wa sa'a kahatain. Me and the hour striking together coming, it's like my two fingers. This is how close they are. So knowing that 1400 years have gone by, we, for us, it's even more emphasis for us to know that the Day of Judgment is much more closer. If at the time when the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was like this, then it's only even more closer for us. And it's something that a lot of us, we tend to forget about, we don't think about the Day of Judgment. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran has to repeatedly remind us about the hour striking and to be worried about your hisab, about your accounting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So inshallah, we're going to go through this passage bi'idhnillahi ta'ala. And we're going to let Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explain for us the situation of the believers and the disbelievers on the Day of Judgment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Az-Zumar, and if you guys want in particular, it's the second last page. It starts from there, the second last page on the bottom, the last ayah to the rest of the surah, the rest of the page. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentions, he says, وَمَا قَدَرُ اللَّهَ حَقَّ قَدَرِهِ وَالْأَرْضُ جَمِيعًا قَبْضَتُهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ وَالسَّمَاوَاتُ مَطَوِيَّاتٌ بِيَمِينِهِ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى أَمَّا يُشْرِكُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَمَا قَدَرُ اللَّهَ حَقَّ قَدَرِهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentions that the people have not given the due veneration, the due praise that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is deserving of. Ibn Kathir, he mentioned specifically that this is referring to the mushrikun, the polytheists, those who worshipped Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but at the same time, they worshipped other things as well. Maybe it was idols, maybe it was the sun and the moon, maybe it was a particular individual, maybe it was their own desires. But those who worshipped besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala something, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا قَدَرُ اللَّهَ حَقَّ قَدَرِهِ. That these people in particular, they haven't venerated Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the way he's supposed to be venerated. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he's al-azim. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone is the one that deserves to be worshipped. Not that you worship Him as someone besides Him. That the people haven't given Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala His due rights. I'm going to read to you the statement of Ibn Kathir. He says that the mushrikun have not venerated Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the veneration that was due to Him. They worship Him with others and He is azeem. He is far from that. He is free from that. And there is no one like Him who has power and ability over other things. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is the only one that has power and ability over everything. And for that reason, the people, they haven't worshipped Him. And they haven't worshipped Him alone as He was due. Ibn Abbas, radiallahu ta'ala anhumah, he says, regarding this ayah, who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is referring to, he says, they are the disbelievers who didn't believe in the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala over them. They didn't believe that Allah has control over them. They didn't believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has the power to destroy them, kill them, bring them back, resurrect them once again, and then hold them to account for what they used to do. They didn't believe that. And so the Ibn Abbas, he says, anyone who believes that Allah is able over everything and Allah has control and power over him, then that person will venerate Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as he deserves to be, by not worshipping Him with partners. But as for the one that doesn't understand that, and he doesn't come to terms that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has power and ability over everything, including himself, then that person will never ever be able to truly venerate Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and praise and worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as he deserves to be worshipped. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he carried on. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, and this is where he goes into the Day of Judgment. He says, وَنُفِخَ فِي السُّورِ فَصَعِقَ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ إِلَّا مَنْ شَاءَ اللَّهِ ثُمَّ نُفِخَ فِيهِ أُخْرَى فَإِذَا هُمْ قِيَامٌ يَنْظُرُونَ. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَنُفِخَ فِي السُّورِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَنُفِخَ فِي السُّورِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, then the trumpet is blown. Now, I'm sure all of us know that when the hour strikes, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He will command one of His angels. Does anybody know what angel is? Anybody? Israfil, right? Angel. Israfil. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will command him to blow the trumpet. To blow the trumpet. What's powerful, and I want you guys to really imagine this with me, okay? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَنُفِخَ فِي السُّورِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and then the trumpet will be blown. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He didn't mention to us who's blowing the trumpet. How do we know who's blowing the trumpet? It's from the hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. From the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is how we come to know who is the one that is blowing the trumpet. But here in this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as He talks about the Day of Judgment, He says, وَنُفِخَ فِي السُّورِ. All He tells you is that the trumpet's going to be blown. He doesn't tell you who. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't want you to bother in regards to who's blowing the trumpet. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't want you to bother in regards to who's doing what. Rather, Allah wants you to pay attention to the reality of the event, what's going to happen. He wants you to focus about what's going to take place. Allah said, وَنُفِخَ فِي السُّورِ فَصَّعِقَ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, at that moment, every single person will come to death. Every single person will die. Anything which is in the sama, which is in the heavens, or which is in the ard, or which is in the earth, every single thing, every single creature is going to come to an end there and then. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, إِلَّا مَنْ شَاءَ اللَّهِ. Except for those who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that they won't. And this in particular, we learn from the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that at that point, every single person will come to an end, except for who? Certain angels. Israfil, Malik al-Mawt. There are particular angels that at this point Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala won't destroy them. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He mentions that the trumpet will be blown, and at that moment every single person will come to an end, except for those who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala willed for them to stay alive, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, ثُمَّ نُفِخَ فِيهِ أُخْرَى. Then a second time the trumpet will be blown. A second time the trumpet will be blown. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَإِذَا هُمْ قِيَامٌ يَنْظُرُونَ. At that point, when the second trumpet is blown, what happens this time? Every single person that had died, every single person that had come to an end, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring them all back to life. Each and every single one of them that had died due to the trumpet blowing. And those that had died before the trumpet had been blown. Those hundreds and thousands of years that people lived on this earth. Each and every single one of them will come out of the graves. And that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, هُمْ قِيَامٌ يَنْظُرُونَ. They will be standing and they'll be waiting. They'll be waiting. Waiting to be called. Waiting for the accounting to take place. Waiting for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Ibn Kathir, he mentions that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that they will come back to life and they'll be standing. They'll be standing with faza', with fear. And their hearts will be shaking and they'll be trembling out of the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Waking up to a place that they've never seen the likes of it before. A day that they've never seen the likes of it before. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he carries on, he says, وَأَشْرَقَتِ الْأَرْضُ بِنُورِ رَبِّهَا. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and then on that day, on the day of judgment, the entire place, the ard, the place in which the day of judgment will take place, وَأَشْرَقَتِ الْأَرْضُ بِنُورِ رَبِّهَا. The light will take over. The light of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will cover everything. وَوُضِيَ الْكِتَابُ. Then the books will be brought forward. The books will be brought forward. Which books are these? These are the books that contain our good actions and our bad actions. These are the books that the angels have spent their life writing down every single thing that we do. Whether it's the good, whether it's the bad. Every little action that we ever did, the actions that we didn't take much notice of, the actions that we didn't consider to be something big, and even the actions that we did consider to be big. Every single one of them were written down into these books. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَوُضِيَ الْكِتَابِ. And again, look what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, that the books will be placed. Allah doesn't mention who's placing the books, because it's not for your concern. It's not for us to worry about who's placing the books. All we have to worry about is the fact that our deeds and our actions are all going to be brought forward. Every action that we did is going to be placed right in front of us. The good actions and the bad actions. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَجِيءَ بِالنَّبِيِّينَ وَالشُّهَدَاءِ وَقُضِيَ بَيْنَهُمْ بِالْحَقِّ وَهُمْ لَا يُظْلَمُونَ. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَجِيءَ, and are brought forth. Who are brought forth? النَّبِيِّينَ, the prophets are brought forth. وَالشُّهَدَاءِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that all of the prophets for every single nation, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring them. وَالشُّهَدَاءِ, and witnesses. The prophets will be brought forward. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to use them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to testify from them. Whether they had delivered the message of Islam. Whether every prophet, when he came, did he deliver and convey the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to its nation. وَالشُّهَدَى. And some of the mufassirun, they mentioned that the shuhada here are not just the amatun nas, the people that will witness at the time when these prophets came, but rather it's referring to the angels that were witnessing every single action that you did, and they witnessed the messengers delivering the message of Islam. They were delivering the message of La ilaha illallah. They were delivering the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that was conveyed to them. That these angels themselves will come out and they will start to testify and become the shuhada, that this prophet and that messenger and this prophet, whether it was Nuh, Ibrahim, the prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whichever one it was, they will testify that each and every single one of them delivered the risala. They delivered the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَقُضِيَ بَيْنَهُمْ بِالْحَقِّ وَهُمْ لَا يُظْلَمُونَ. And then the truth will be settled between them. The haqq will be settled between them. The haqq will be settled between those who the message it was conveyed to, but they didn't take heed of that message. وَهُمْ لَا يُظْلَمُونَ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that these people, they won't be oppressed. Meaning what? That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring forward every single good deed that they did, even if it was small. Allah's not going to oppress you on that day. Even if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will punish you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala won't let even the smallest of good deed that you did go away. And at the same time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not add extra to the evil sins that you did. Allah will bring exactly what you did. He won't add from it, he won't take from it. Whether it was good, whether it was bad. But Allah won't oppress you on that day. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, وَوُفِّيَتْ كُلُّ نَفْسٍ مَا عَمِلَتْ وَهُوَ أَعْلَمُ بِمَا يَفْعَلُونَ. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that every single soul, every single individual will be compensated with that which they did. Those who did good, they will be given that which they will be given in return for that. And those that did bad, and they did sins, and they came with major sins, whether it was kufr, whether it was shirk, whether it was just normal major sins and minor sins, each and every single person will get what they came with. They'll be compensated for that. وَهُوَ أَعْلَمُ بِمَا يَفْعَلُونَ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all knowing of what they actually did. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows every single action that you did. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He talks about the people that will go towards Jahannam. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, وَسِيقَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا إِلَى جَهَنَّمَ زُمَرًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He tells us, وَسِيقَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He mentions that the kuffar, the disbelievers, they will be taken. They will be taken. Where? إِلَى جَهَنَّمَ زُمَرًا. They will be taken in groups. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that they will be driven all the way to Jahannam in groups and groups and groups and many different groups, depending on the sins that they did, how high it was, how low it was. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said they will be taken to Jahannam. حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءُهَا فُتِحَتْ أَبْوَابُهَا وَقَالَ لَهُمْ خَزَنَتُهَا أَلَمْ يَأْتِكُمْ رُسُلٌ مِّنْكُمْ. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that they will be driven. They will be driven to Jahannam, to the hellfire. And as they're driven, as they get there, وَفُتِحَتْ أَبَوَابُ جَهَنَّمْ, the doors of Jahannam will be open. The gates of Jahannam will be open. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that it will be said to them. It will be said to them by those guardians of these gates. Those who guard the gates of Jahannam, it will be said to them. They will say to these kuffar that are being driven into Jahannam, they will say, أَلَمْ يَأْتِكُمْ رُسُلٌ مِّنْكُمْ يَتْلُونَ عَلَيْكُمْ آيَاتِ رَبِّكُمْ وَيُنذِرُونَكُمْ لِقَاءَ يَوْمِكُمْ هَذَا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that they will say to these kuffar, to these disbelievers, didn't a messenger come to you? Didn't a messenger just like you, meaning a human being just like you, didn't he come to you? And didn't he read the verses of your Lord to you, of your Rabb? Didn't he recite these ayat upon you? And didn't he warn you that a day will come like this in which you will meet your Rabb? That a day like this will come in which you will have to face Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then they will reply back. Qalu, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, they said, Bala. They said, of course. Of course. Someone did come to us. Someone did come and deliver the message of Allah. Someone did come and warn us that a day will come in which we'll be held to account for the actions that we did. But we decided to ignore them. And we decided to disbelieve in them. وَلَكِنْ حَقَّتْ كَلِمَةُ الْعَذَابِ عَلَى الْكَافِرِينَ. And then they will say, but this is the true punishment that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned is going to come to us now. The true punishment that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that will come to the disbelievers is now taking place. We ignored. We didn't listen. We didn't pay attention. In Surah Al-Mulk, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, when the people of the hellfire, when they'll be asked, why? Why did you come here? Didn't anyone come to you? Didn't anyone inform you? And they say, yes, someone did come. But they're going to, what's their excuse? They're going to say, لَوْ كُنَّ نَسْمَعُ أَوْ نَعْكِلُ مَا كُنَّا فِي أَصْحَابِ السَّعِيرِ. They're going to say, if only, أَوْ نَعْكِلُ. If only we use our intellect. And if only we listen. If only we use our brains. And we listen to the message that was given to us. We wouldn't today be amongst the people of the fire. We wouldn't today be amongst the people of the hellfire. Two characteristics. If only they listened to that which was being taught to them, the ayat and the ahadith, and then they understood it. And they thought about it. And they realized that this life isn't a joke. And that a day will come that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will question us. And then we'll be either thrown into Jahannam or we'll be thrown into Jannah. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, قِيلَ دَخُلُوا أَبَوَابَ جَهَنَّمَ خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا فَبِئْسَ مَثْوَى الْمُتَكَبِّرِينَ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, it will be said to these people that were being dragged towards the hellfire, it will be said to them, أُدْخُلُوا أَبَوَابَ جَهَنَّمَ خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا. Enter into the gates of Jahannam and live there forever. Live there forever. فَبِئْسَ مَثْوَى الْمُتَكَبِّرِينَ. This is the abode. This is the place in which they are going to live. Who? Al-mutakabbirin. Those that were arrogant. Those that were arrogant. And they decided to ignore the ayat and the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Those mutakabbirin, this is the place that they're going to live. You know, wallahi, something very powerful that I read regarding this ayah today. When I was reading the tafsir of Ibn Kathir, he mentioned a very powerful benefit. He said, well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that it will be said to them, enter into Jannah. Allah says, قِيلَ دَخُلُوا. He says, it will be said to them. Again, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he didn't mention who is saying to these people, who was saying to this kuffar to enter into Jahannam. And he mentioned there's two reasons why. Number one, again, because it's not necessary for us to know. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to focus on the reality of the event and what's taking place. He doesn't want you to focus about who's saying what and who's doing what. But he mentions that there's another powerful benefit. He says that the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he didn't pinpoint and mention in particular who is the one that said, who is going to say sorry to these kuffar to enter into Jahannam, it means that it's unrestricted. Meaning, the angels will say it. The people will say it. The believers will say it. Every single person that knows the situation of a kafir, and he knows his hal, and he knows that he's going to enter into Jahannam, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that each and every single one of them will say, وَدُخُلُوا أَبَوَابَ جَهَنَّمَ خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا. Every single person will say it to them. Every single person will tell them, go. Go, go, enter into Jahannam. فَبِئْسَ مَثْوَى الْمُتَكَبِّرِينَ. What a terrible abode this is for you, arrogant people. You chose to be arrogant towards the verses of Allah, that's exactly where you're going to stay. That's exactly where you're going to live. And then after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentions about the people, the kuffar entering into Jahannam, he then changes and he starts to talk about the people of Ahlul Jannah. He starts to talk about Ahlul Jannah, the people of Jannah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَسِيقَ الَّذِينَ اتَّقَوْا رَبَّهُمْ إِلَى الْجَنَّةِ زُمَرًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he then says that when the people who had taqwa, the people that had taqwa, they had good consciousness, they had piety, they were aware of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they were constantly worried about falling into haram. Those people, وَسِيقَ الَّذِينَ اتَّقَوْا رَبَّهُمْ إِلَى الْجَنَّةِ زُمَرًا. When they are brought towards Jannah in groups, زُمَرًا, again in groups. And as Ibn Kathir, he mentions that the groups that the Muslims will come and the groups that the believers will come towards Jannah is according to their ranks. So first it will be the groups of the messengers, then it will be groups of as-siddiqeen, and then the shuhada. It will come the truthful ones, and then the martyrs, and then the righteous people, and then those that come after them, that come after them. Each of them will come into groups towards Al-Jannah. They will come towards Al-Jannah. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءُهَا وَفُتِحَتْ أَبَوَابُهَا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and as they're coming towards Jannah, what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala do? The gates of Jannah are already open for them. The gates of Jannah are already open. When the people, when the kuffar, they came to Jahannam, the gates were closed. And as they came close to it, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opened it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, as for the people of Jannah, due to the honor that these people hold, for the good actions that they used to do, and the ta'at that they used to come with, in obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as they are being taken to Jannah, the gates are already open for them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he honors his guests, he honors his slaves, and he opens the gate. حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءُهَا وَفُتِحَتْ أَبَوَابُهَا وَقَالَ لَهُمْ. And then it is said to them, خَزَنَتُهَا, the one who is in guard of the gates of Jannah, he says, سَلَامٌ عَلَيْكُمْ, peace be upon you. سَلَامٌ عَلَيْكُمْ, peace be upon you. You know what the word salam means? You know when I say salam to you, you know when you go to your Muslim brother and you say assalamu alaikum. You know what you're really basically saying? You're saying, I'm not going to harm you and you're not going to harm me. There's peace between us. There's no beef between us. We're calm, there's nothing. Salamun alaikum. The angel at the gate of Jannah, he will look at you and he will say, Salamun alaikum. Salamun alaikum. As a benefit, who is the first person that's going to come to the gate of Jannah? Does anybody know? The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And a hadith mentioned in Sahih Muslim, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that I will be the first one to knock on the gates of Al-Jannah. I'll be the first one to come to the gates of Jannah. And then in another hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, I will come to the doors of Jannah. I will come to the gates of Jannah. And I will request for them to open it. And when I request for it to be opened, the God of Al-Jannah, he will say to me, Man ant, who are you? Who are you? And then the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will reply back and he will say, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then the guardian of Al-Jannah, he will say that I was commanded to never to open this gate for anyone until you came. You will be the first person that I'll open the gate for. No one before you will I ever open the gate for. And the hadith is mentioned in Imam Ahmad's Musnad. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will have the door open for them. And they will say, Salamun alaykum, tibatum fadkhuluha khalideen. They will say, tibatum, meaning, Salamun alaykum, peace be upon you. Today, you are purified. You are purified. Your actions are purified. The place in which you're going to is purified. Your speech is purified. Everything about you and where you're going to, all of it Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says it's purified for you. It becomes good and pure. All of that bad that was there before, all of it goes. Your a'mal, your actions will become good. And your speech will become good. And the place in which you will reside for the rest of your life will be good. And wallahi, you know, at this point, subhanAllah, Ibn Kathir, rahimahullah ta'ala, he brings in his tafsir so many ahadith regarding the description of Jannah. And wallahi, today, after a very long time, I actually spent time looking into the description of Jannah. Wallahi, it was something else. I remember this morning I woke up, I was a bit stressed. And I said to myself, I need to prepare this talk, and I did it last minute, subhanAllah. And as I was reading the description of Jannah, wallahi, it brought peace to my heart. Wallahi, it brought peace to my heart. The beautiful things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes, the women that you'll get in Jannah, they'll be waiting for you as you enter in. Allahu Akbar, brothers, be excited. Wallahi, it's beautiful. But I thought to myself, it's better to describe Jannah in a different lecture, particularly just for Al-Jannah, because there's so many ahadith and so many things that you can go into. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, as they told, فَدَخُلُوهَا خَالِدِينَ, enter inside of it forever, live in here forever. There's never going back. Once you enter inside Jannah, once you've entered in Al-Jannah, there's never going back. That's going to be your place of stay, a place of peace and tranquility, not like the people of Ahlul Jahannam, and where they're going to stay. A terrible place. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَقَالُوا الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ الَّذِي صَدَقَنَا وَعَدَهُ وَأَوْرَثَنَا الْأَرْضَ لَتَبَوَّأُ مِنَ الْجَنَّةِ حَيْثُ نَشَاءُ. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentions something powerful. He says, they will say, the people of Jannah, the believers, the Muslims, us inshaAllah, when they enter inside Jannah, they will say, Alhamdulillah. They'll say all praises for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They'll praise and glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they'll show gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They say, Alladhi, the one, Sadaqana wa'ada. He's truthful. He was truthful in his promise. He was truthful in his promise in what? In two things. That a day will come in which you will be held to account for the actions that you did. And that if you come with the righteous actions, you will enter into Al-Jannah. You will enter into this garden, this paradise, if you come with the righteous actions. So they say, Alhamdulillah alladhi sadaqana wa'adah. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that they will say, وَأَوْرَثَنَا الْأَرْضَ نَتَبَوَّأُ مِنَ الْجَنَّةِ حَيْثُ نَشَاءُ. And this is powerful. And they say, وَأَوْرَثَنَا الْأَرْضَ. And he inherited us with this earth, with this land. And the land that the people of Jannah are talking about is Al-Jannah itself. They say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us this ard. And some of the Mufassirun, they say, why did Allah mention the word awrathana? Why did He mention inherited? Why is it that the believers are inheriting this earth? And they said, because the place in which they've gone into, it was supposed to be for these people that went Jahannam. Initially, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it for them. But the fact that they came with bad actions, and they came with kufr and disbelief, that place was now inherited over to the believers. And the believers were given that inheritance. And they were given the place in which these disbelievers, they would have been in. And they would have shared with the believers. Now because they're in Jahannam, all of the believers are inheriting that. They've been given that place in Jannah. Why نَتَبَوَّأُ مِنَ الْجَنَّةِ حَيْثُ نَشَاءُ. And so that we may settle in paradise and we can live in Jannah wherever we want. Wherever you want in Jannah. It's garden, it's huge. Well, like I said, the description of Jannah in regards to how large it is, it said you can live wherever you want. You will live wherever you want in Al-Jannah. You've got the choice. It's so large. No one's going to say to you, you can't stay here and you can't stay there. Live wherever you want. Wherever you wish, you can live there. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He ends the surah and He says, وَتَرَى الْمَلَائِكَةَ حَافِينَ مِنْ حَوْلِ الْعَرْشِ يُسَبِّحُونَ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّهِمْ وَقُضِيَ بَيْنَهُمْ بِالْحَقِّ وَقِيلَ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and you will see the angels. You will see the angels at this point. حَافِينَ مِنْ حَوْلِ الْعَرْشِ. They'll be surrounding around the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, around the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. يُسَبِّحُونَ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّهِمْ. And they will be praising their Lord. They'll be praising and glorifying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَقُضِيَ بَيْنَهُمْ بِالْحَقِّ وَقِيلَ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. And from amongst them, everything would have been judged. Everything, all the judgment will come to an end. وَقُضِيَ بَيْنَهُمْ بِالْحَقِّ وَقِيلَ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. And once the judgment has finished and it's come to an end, the believers will say, الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. All praises for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Rabb, the Master, the Lord of the Alameen of the world. That was, in short, the passage from Surah Az-Zumar. Wallahi, there was so much details I could have gone into, but it's just because we don't have time. When you go to Tafsir ibn Kathir, or even the Tafsir by Imam al-Qurtubi, or Shaykh Abdul Rahman ibn Nasir Sa'di, or Imam al-Baghawi, you know, or Muhammad Amin al-Shanqiti, rahimahumullahu ta'ala jami'an. When you go to the tafaseer and you look at the explanation that they give regarding this page, it's in pages. It's in pages. And a lot of it, I don't have time, so we can't really explain it in details. But that gives us a good understanding in regards to the situation on the Day of Judgment. That when the trumpet's blown, the stages that it will go through, first the trumpet will be blown once, and then twice. The first time everyone will die, the second time everyone will be resurrected. And then Allah will bring the prophets, and then the shuhada and the witnesses, and the accounting will take place. And then the people will be told, you're going to go Jahannam, you're going to go Jannah. Those that are going to go Jahannam, they'll be thrown. And they'll be questioned, why did you come here? And they'll say, because, you know, we just didn't listen, we disbelieved. And as for the people of Jannah, they'll be given glad tidings, and they'll be told to enter into paradise with peace. And then you will see that the angels and everybody will be praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Anything which I said which was wrong is from me, and shaitan and Allah and his messenger are free from it. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.
Hey guys, I really hope that you benefited from that video. Before you go, I want to ask you a really important question. Have you guys ever thought about studying Islam and seeking knowledge? If not, then I want you to reflect upon this hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet said that seeking knowledge is obligatory upon every single Muslim. Of course, that doesn't mean you have to be a scholar, but you have to know the basics in order for you to be the best possible slave and worshipper of Allah that you can possibly be. So we decided to provide a solution for this. You see, many people want to study, but they don't have the means or the resources to do so. So we set up an online institute called the Knowledge College, where you can study Islam from the comfort of your own home. So if you want more information on the Knowledge College and you'd like to sign up, go to the link below, check out the website, and hopefully we see you on the other side. Assalamu alaikum.